Hi, everybody. Welcome. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, based on wherever you're joining us from, whatever part of the world. Welcome to our Dime December webinar. It's already December, can you imagine? The holiday seasons, and we'll just give another minute or so for people who are trying to join and tune in today. But those of you who have not joined Dime webinar before are new to it. I'm Smith Patel, Director of Digital Medicine here, and at Dime, our mission is to advance safe, effective, ethical, and equitable use of digital health to optimize human health. And these Dime webinars are absolute favorite time of the month, where we get to bring in leading experts from the field, from various disciplines, to talk about some of the critical topics on the digital medicine with our community. And today we have some amazing experts today who actually is a new research committee that kicked off earlier this year. And here we are today, a couple of months later, they're making strides and they're super excited to share some of their findings and acceleration in this work. So thank you for all the work that you do, everyone. Before we dive in, I will go ahead and share my screen and we'll do a little bit of the housekeeping in just a second to make sure that we are all aligned. Here we go, perfect. So for everyone who's on the call, today's session is being recorded and the recordings along with slides would be available on Dime's website within the next 48 hours. So please tune in and you can always go back and hear. And the magic of these kinds of intimate conversations and webinars are to ask questions and to make sure you're engaged. So please, if you have any questions, drop it in the chat box in the Zoom chat, and or we have a live Q&A function at the end, so you can raise your hand and we can bring you in live to ask a live question. Today's topic is one of my favorite topics because COVID-19, as we saw, have exposed some of the inadequacies and inequities in the field of digital medicine. You know, when we think about designing solutions, we have to keep in mind the cultural, the gaps that exist from the language barriers, from the infrastructure problems, from the technological access barriers. How are we going to do that? Where do we start? How we can make research and development more equitable? These are exactly the conversations that we will dive in today. So I'm really excited, and I would love to introduce to us our research committee co-chair and an incredible leader in the field who I admire a lot, Isaac Rodriguez. Isaac? Floor is all yours.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Patel, for the kind introduction. And I welcome everyone, the panelists, my distinguished panelists, and all of you online who are attending this webinar. The topic is really important. It's digital medicine research and development in low resource settings. This is something that is critical from multiple perspectives, and we will be discussing that today. Evidently, we are doing clinical research more and more and on a global basis using digital tools, and digital medicine is happening more and more on a global basis as well. So our distinguished panelists, which I have the great honor to share this session with all of you today, are the following. Santosh Shivay, who is an independent healthcare consultant. He is a digital health consultant based in Mumbai, India. He works with biopharma and medtech organizations, startups, and government on digital health strategy, outcome-oriented program designs, and guidance on implementation and delivery. Before starting his consulting work in 2018, he held various leadership roles in Novartis, Johnson & Johnson, and Pfizer, working on more than 50 drug development projects over 14 years. Our next panelist is Brené Bent. Dr. Brené Bent is a digital health data scientist at Age Analytics. Brené is a digital health data scientist in that organization and the lead developer of the digital biomarker discovery pipeline, an open source software platform to developing digital biomarkers from mHealth and wearable data. Brené previously worked with the NSF Assist Center developing wearable sensor hardware. And during her PhD, she developed methods for non-invasive glucose monitoring using a smartwatch and led a number of projects ranging from wearable sensors validation to human activity recognition. Renee's research has resulted in over 25 publications in multiple invited talks, including tech talks. Next, we have our next panelist is Amy Xiong. Dr. Xiong is holding a doctorate in public health and has 30 plus years of career focused on health disparities, vulnerable populations, and social determinants of health. Impressive. Amy now provides digital health equity consultation to leading health systems and technology companies through her firm, Public Health Innovations LLC. She is a member of the DIMES Data Collaborative Community and the executive board of Nudge, Nudge Health, the network for digital evidence in health. And last but not least, we have Christopher, Dr. Christopher James. He's a professor at the University of Warwick in England. Christopher has been a biomedical engineer academic for almost 30 years with research interests in application in brain and behavior, extracting information from brain signal recordings and from behavior monitoring using artificial intelligence and machine learning techniques. And in all of this, I forgot to mention that I am working as a senior vice president for scientific and clinical affairs at ICON PLC, and I am the research co-chair for the research committee, this committee that is presenting to all of you today. So with those introductions, I will welcome all of you panelists, and our next presentation will be by Santosh. Go to the next slide, please. Oh, so actually it was me. So a few things to say before we actually go on to the presentation by each of the panelists. The DIME Research Committee really is a vibrant group of professionals and leaders in the field that are driving the vision of the DIME Society, the Digital Medicine Society. We really focus on three major areas, which are generation of evidence, scientific medical evidence that can be utilized for the benefit of the entire field. We facilitate collaborations among multiple organizations to work on projects that are of interest for the community. And evidently, we promote education in the field of digital medicine, digital endpoints, digital technologies for the improvement of health outcomes in our societies. And with that, next. So we now have Santosh, who is going to be discussing his section. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Isaac, for that very nice introduction. So let's begin from the beginning. Why are we even talking about digital medicine and associated research and development in low resource settings? And there are a lot of thoughts that can go with this. But if we go back and start thinking about why digital medicine, importance of digital health and associated interventions began. And if you realize that most of these things were actually related to a lot of shortcomings that were identified because of limited resources that were available in the healthcare. So if we go to the next slide, we will realize that many of these areas, the impact areas of digital medicine interventions, match the exact needs in those rural settings. So if we are thinking about, basically starting from efficient resource utilization, the financial challenges that come with managing healthcare for large populations, thinking about human resources, both clinical and as well as non-clinical resources that need to support this, and their ever-growing importance, but also their ever-growing limitations when it comes to, again, managing these in a low-resource setting, are definitely some things that digital medicine intervention started to think about and to have the impact on. And of course, infrastructure-wise, whether it is infrastructure to support many of these healthcare delivery systems and also their support in diagnosis, in prevention, treatment, and ongoing management. That's another area that is typically associated with digital safety. And again, an impact area for digital. Optimal care delivery, understanding the quality of delivery, understanding the accuracy and the places where it needs to be delivered, timely delivery, all these facets of care delivery also get associated with digital medicine intervention are supposed to be impact areas, and also a very huge need for these. And so I can go on and on about talking about how these things sort of exactly match with each other, the impact areas that digital medicine interventions are taught to be thinking about, and those which we are talking about when it comes to resource settings. And then, so what do we see in the picture, in the field? And so myself being a part of the research committee, together with a very professional and knowledgeable working group, some of whom are also on this webinar, started thinking about and understand about what is actually happening in the field. And if we go to the next slide, we will reveal what we have seen. And what we have actually seen through our initial work is the picture on the field is very different. So all of us and a lot of other people who are maybe related to healthcare or maybe technology are working at the cusp of these two things. Everybody is very excited about these digital medicine interventions, right? But what we have seen so far, and this is something that we will discuss also through the webinar, is these interventions already are struggling even in the so-called normal setting, right? And so the low resource settings is you know, a far-fetched idea when it comes to these interventions. And so if we go to the next slide, we will see that how these things are not keeping in, you know, pace with whatever is happening on the intervention, the innovation field, and what is happening on the ground. There is definitely a paucity of a systematic approach to these digital medicine interventions, innovations. So, you know, going from a strategy to design to implementation kind of pathway that clearly is lacking, and we see a lot of evidence in this area. Dime's own work has shown that these are related to digital clinical measures. Are not keeping pace with rapid expansion and adoption of digital sensing. You go to the academic research and you start seeing some of these elements which was recently published by many of our experts at the time. This lack of evidence gathering, as I mentioned, you know, is already having an impact in the so-called normal settings. And of course, if they don't work in the normal settings where feel that the resources are already at an optimal phase to implement these interventions, they will definitely have a dominant impact on those. So going to the next slide now, we also try to check, go beyond the small academic published research and try to get feedback from the field. And it continues to suggest a worrying picture. Entrepreneurs are interested in designing, piloting, implementing many of these interventions in their own local low resource settings, but they face a very fragmented picture of, you know, starting from funding, the regulation, commercialization challenges, and then ultimately leading to lack of sustainability for interventions. We also checked with clinicians, they face also the similar ideas and the lack of support with these ideas. They understand what is needed in their experts. But they are often not approached at all, or only approached at later stages, thereby actually reducing the impact of the feedback that we are looking at when it comes to some of these things. We will know more about user patient. We have Amy with us, and I think she will talk about this. But their involvement has also been quite minimal, and only, you know, empirical feedback is collected when it comes to some of the items. So is the picture very bleak? Actually, no. So if you go to the next slide, we'll see that actually there are now some interesting initiatives that are happening. For example, WHO recently released a compendium that showed how innovative health technologies can be assessed for implementation in low resource settings. And they included some interesting products which fit the definition of a digital medicine. Dime itself has been working actively in this field, including our work on the Health Equity and Access Leadership Heal Coalition. And of course, on the last slide that I will talk about, you know, we are definitely doing this at the research group level. So on the next slide, I've shown that our research group, as I mentioned earlier, we continue to study this field. We want to bring these insights further from the field and understand why that is happening. But we do not want to leave it at this research kind of hypothesis level. So our aim for the research group is definitely to provide practical tools for entrepreneurs, for clinicians, for governments, for policymakers, for you know, really, really impactful design, strategy, and implementation of these important innovations in the research sector. With that, I hand over to you.
Thank you so much, Santosh. So I'm really excited to be chatting with you all today on behalf of the V3 plus U3 Research Working Group. We've been developing a comprehensive foundational evaluation framework for biomets or biometric monitoring technologies, building upon the V3 verification, analytical validation, and clinical validation framework that was developed by Goldsack et al. In 2020. And we're adding U3, so utility, usability, and user experience testing and evaluation. A primary focus for our group has been on incorporating equity, diversity, and inclusion into the U3 evaluation framework. And so I'm going to be sharing a few of those ideas with you today, specifically in the context of usability R&D recommendations for digital medicine product deployment in low resource settings. And I would like to say that the U3 framework has been a team effort. I've highlighted the team member names here on this slide, and actually both of our moderators today, Smit and Isaac, are both team members of this team. So the ideas that I'm sharing today have been developed by the incredible people listed here. I'm merely a vessel for the ideas today. All right, if we go to the next slide. Awesome, so let's start by defining what usability is. According to ISO 92-4111, usability is concerned with the effectiveness, efficiency, and satisfaction with which specified end users achieve specified goals in particular environments. Now, this is extremely important to the success of a digital medicine product because it answers questions such as, is the product easy and intuitive to use? Does the end user like the way the product is designed, looks, and feels? Is the product safe to use? And does the product impede in any way daily living? If the answer is unfavorable in any of these questions, a person may never actually utilize the digital medicine product, or adherence may be very low. So testing and evaluation of the usability of a digital medicine product is just very critical to the entire R&D process. And then next slide, please. Utility is another U in U3 and refers to whether a digital medicine product has appropriate features and meets the needs of end users. So utility is concerned with ensuring that a user's needs are met and that the product is useful to that user. And then next slide, please. And then the third U is user experience, or UX. So UX is concerned with all aspects of the end user's level of satisfaction when interacting with the product. So this would include desirability and brand trust, and then just in general, overall user satisfaction with a product. And so if you think about user retention, that's a really important component of UX testing. And then next slide, please. So in the next section, Amy is going to go into a lot more detail into some of the U3 considerations in low resource settings, but I wanted to introduce them briefly here to set the stage for why usability testing and evaluation is so critical in low resource settings specifically. So dependence on smartphones and access to broadband internet are essential for the use of most digital medicine products. This isn't something that many of us think about, but it can significantly hinder the deployment of these devices in rural areas and in low-income populations. And then another barrier to usability of digital medicine products includes digital literacy, which may or may not be correlated with language barriers due to the product educational materials and/or interfaces not being available across languages. Digital literacy is often lower in areas with low resources. And so it's something for us to be acutely aware of when designing a digital medicine product to be deployed in these settings. And then a lack of trust in technology may also be a barrier to entry for digital medicine products in low resource settings. Additionally, vulnerable populations, including people with disabilities, older adults, and children, are typically not included in U3 testing or evaluation at all. And then finally, even if we are able to deploy digital medicine products in low resource settings, there is often very low adherence and high abandonment rates. So for example, almost a third of wearables are abandoned within the first 6 months of use. Next slide, please. So with all of these challenges and considerations for U3 evaluation, what can the digital medicine community do to make usability research and development more inclusive and accessible in low resource settings? Our paper, release date TBD, includes a number of recommendations for improving usability testing to be more equitable. And I've summarized a few of these here that I think are relevant in low resource settings specifically. First, you want to engage with users as early as possible in the design and development of digital medicine products. This is really critical to do, especially including users in low resource settings whenever possible to ensure that you're not overlooking any important U3 considerations. Second, you want to leverage more diverse user personas during your design and development of digital medicine products. This includes thinking about personas that may have a lower digital literacy skills or may live in a rural location without access to consistent broadband internet access. This is really critical to the design phase, is really thinking about these user personas and who's going to be using the end product. And then in examining some of the usability considerations we discussed earlier, developing linguistically and culturally tailored products to engage diverse populations, and designing and developing workflows and training programs to encourage opportunities for diverse populations and or populations in low resource settings is really critical. Something that the V3 plus U3 working group is keenly focused on is to promote evaluation of technologies with a focus on equity as a value measure to really drive decision-making. And our primary goal with this group is to advocate for rigorous standardization that includes U3 in order to ensure that all patients or users are equally served. And finally, something that everyone in the digital medicine community can do is to advocate for equitable implementation of digital health tools within the healthcare system. And with that, I'm going to go ahead and pass the torch to Amy. Thank you so much for listening.
Thanks so much. So I haven't been part of the development of this project, so I'm coming at it from a little bit of a different perspective. And one of those perspectives is that I don't think of things in terms of low and high resource settings. I think of people who have low or high resources who may all be seen within the same setting of, say, a healthcare system. And but regardless, I really underscore the message of the need to engage people who have low resources, regardless of the setting. I'm going to really focus on why we really need to address the digitally marginalized populations in digital medicine development and deployment. If you look at the life expectancy of people in the United States, those with incomes at 100, the top 1% income, their life expectancy is about 85 years. And if you go down to the 50th income percentile, it's a significant drop, but not that dramatic on the global scale. But once income in the US drops to the 50th percentile, you can see that life expectancy has dropped significantly. But when you go down to the lowest 1% of income, the life expectancy is somewhat similar to war-torn, impoverished nations that suffer famine and malnourishment. And so You know, you have to look at those, at that kind of disparity. And we see a lot of that kind of being confounded or showing up when you look at racial and gender differences. So white women live about over 80 years, whereas African-American men on average live about 73 years. And so that's kind of one dimension of it. But go ahead to the next slide, please. We know that health care actually makes very little impact on those health disparities. Experts believe really only about 20% of those disparities is accounted for because of health care, whereas social and economic factors and behavioral factors account for much, much more. And you have to think about the behavioral factors as actually being mediated by the social and economic factors. So for example, if you are a poor person of color living in a segregated neighborhood, you are going to be subjected to advertising of sin products, alcohol and tobacco, and the only, you know, piece of lettuce you might be able to find in your neighborhood is on a fast food hamburger sandwich. So, you know, behavior isn't entirely up to the individual. Go ahead, the next, if you click, there we go. So these you know, sort of 70% are the social determinants of health. And we know that education and income are the two biggest factors. But then all these other things about the neighborhood levels. And the reason that the digital connectivity issues are so important, if you click one more time, or there you go, you can see how many of the social determinants of health require you to be digitally connected in this day and age. So basically, if you don't have the internet, you can't apply for a job, you can't engage in education, which are the two best ways to improve your health. And so it's the compounding of these factors that's why digital marginalization is such an equity issue. Go ahead to the next slide. And in fact, when we look at who has various kinds of devices, we see that in the middle panel, there are some differences by race, but by income is where you see enormous differences, particularly in who has desktop computers. And we know smartphones are absolutely wonderful, but it's not an equitable solution if you're in a family where there's only one smartphone that may have a cracked screen that the kid is, you know, sitting outside the closed McDonald's trying to do their homework. And when you think about, you know, to be highly functional and digitally included, you really need to have a smartphone and a desktop and home broadband. And when you look at who has that by income, you see just enormous disparities. Okay, next slide. So I want to raise the concept of digital inclusion, which is put out by the National Digital Inclusion Alliance. It's a group that I did a fellowship with the year before the pandemic, started. But they acknowledge that you have to have devices, skills, and connectivity really before it makes sense to try to teach someone to use a digital health tool. People have to have the basics. You are wasting your breath if you're trying to teach someone how to use a patient portal to the electronic health record if they don't have a device to access the portal with, for example. There also has to be technical support, and of course, applications have to be appropriate. And of course, that's the big concern of this group. Go ahead, next slide. And so I have developed a model that I use with health systems, but I think it also applies to digital medicine development. And these are all the things you have to bring together to be able to include the digitally marginalized in your product development. The first thing you need to do is monitor for equity. Who are you including? Who aren't you including in your testing? And who is and isn't using the product? it's really important to encourage everybody, don't make pre-assumptions about whether or not people have the technology and skills, but you need to screen everybody for their device connectivity and skill gaps. If they need any of those, refer them to a digital navigator who's trained to help fill those gaps. You can find them through partnerships with community organizations that are expert in doing this. And then once people have all those skills, you involve a digital health coach to teach the specific skills needed for that digital health product. And think about training people who are digitally marginalized or were digitally marginalized to be people who provide input to the design and deployment phase. Last slide. If you want to learn more, I've co-authored a paper, Digital Inclusion as a Social Determinant of Health, and also with Node Health, put out a sort of algorithm for digital medicine testing that I think dovetails really nicely with the product that this group has put out. Also, the Telehealth Equity Coalition, who I'm the research director for them, has published several stories with data on equity issues related to digital health. So I will stop there. Thank you very much.
Excellent. And that brings it to me. So I'm an academic, and I'm going to give a perspective of the development and the lower technology readiness levels, you know, the lower TRLs, where we're going to think about what is it that we need to be developing from a technological perspective to try and help, you know, this challenging framework that we're working in. And I think the first thing I always say in this area is that it's very clear that we're going from this old model of care, which used to focus on illness, acute conditions, very reactive to a condition, very much centered around the hospital. And you went into the hospital, got treated, went home, forgot about your health, something else happened, you went back in and so on. So very disjointed. Of course, the doctor was king, you know, that you did as you were told. And you as the patient, you were a passive recipient. You did as you were told. You took the care that you were told you needed. And that was it, you know, very much a one-sided thing. And of course, the use of technology, ICT, was quite rare. But in actual fact, we're now moving, next slide, please. We're actually moving to this new model of care, which is now focusing more on longer term conditions and more on prevention and continuing care. So no longer this disjoint episodic way of dealing with things. And what's more, we're integrating with people's lives into their home, into their community. So the care of the people is happening around their needs, around their requirements. It's a team-based care, so the idea is that you're sharing records. It isn't the king, the doctor is king, but rather the patient is now a partner, and self-care is indeed encouraged and supported. And of course, to do this, what we find is that there is this dependence on ICT and devices as the sort of the mechanism to allow us to do this. Okay, so next slide, please. So given this framework, here's some of the challenges. So here's an example in the UK. There are 1.2 million wheelchair users in England, which is, you know, and a wheelchair from in terms of health technology is a relatively simplistic health technology, which has been around for decades. Next slide, please. But it turns out that more than half of these users will entirely abandon this product and service. So this is a technology which has been around for decades. It's a relatively easy technology to master, yet still technology like this is being abandoned. So what hope do we have for these higher level technologies which require so much extra? Next slide, please. So in sort of the grants, the research funding and the research projects that I've been involved in, we've had conversations. And here's some quotes from assistive technology and rehabilitative technology clinicians. And they say, we have no idea what the patient does outside the clinic. we have no idea how the patient interacts with their technology on a daily basis. So we give them the technology, we say, go away and use it, it's good for you. But we don't really know how they use it. And what's more, even if we did, we don't truly understand the compliance and the efficacy of this individually prescribed healthcare technology. So we may even prescribe that you go and do something with this technology, but A, we don't know if you're doing it, we don't know if you're doing it well, and even if you are, we don't really know what effect it's having until you come back into the clinic afterwards and we try and figure out what's going on. So even if the technology makes it to the home, there are further challenges. Next slide, please. So, okay, talking about the technology, and we're talking about taking technology into the home. Now, clearly, you can't take CT scanners and MRIs and all that type of thing into the home. So here's a little graph sort of comparing size against how wearable or immobile things are in the home. And you can see in there you have laptops and computers and smartphones, smartwatches, tablets. In the top right corner, we have smart clothing. And in the bottom left, you have fixed sensors, things which are relatively small but are stuck. And we generally, and I'm generalizing a lot here, talk about in the sort of the top left corner, where we're talking about devices which are usually small and relatively portable. So smartwatches, smartphones, and consumer devices which are relatively portable. But of course, that is the sort of the infrastructure that we have to work with if we're trying to work in this away from the clinic environment. Next slide, please. So this is an interesting cartoon. This appeared not almost as soon as the iPhone appeared, this cartoon. And I found it, I mean, it's quite interesting. I'm emailing you a 3D image of the baby I just took with the sonogram function. And it shows you right from the word go, the expectations, if you like, of this technology in the home. You know, these iPhones are amazing. That this technology has the potential to do quite a lot. We can't really do sonograms yet, but technologically, it's not that, you know, it's not a million miles away. The question is, do we want to do that? That's a different story. But this, I think this slide captures the expectation of this type of technology away from the clinic in a healthcare setting. Next slide, please. And so what do we have when we look at when we're in the home nowadays? Basically, it's a big buzzword, big data. And here's an example of the sort of big data that is flying around the world on a single day online. I'm not going to read them all, but there's basically a lot of data coming out of our everyday lives, and a lot of data, not necessarily health data, just data about what we are doing as individuals, as families, as groups, broken down by nation, where we live, you know, the type of infrastructure that we have around us, etc., etc., etc. So there's quite a lot of data floating around. So next slide, please. And so how can we actually make use of that data? And this is the sort of the angle that I'm trying to push in our research. For example, here's just some information that you can gather simply by looking at the electricity usage of a particular home. You can tell things like if the fridge has been opened, if the hairdryer has been used, if the water heater has been switched on or off. Similarly, you can tell when the home heating is on, when the lighting. So by finding intelligent analysis of this type of data, we can also tell quite a lot about well-being. So for example, in the case of a frail elderly person living on their own, where their independence may be challenged, by monitoring this type of technology, we could have a passive way of monitoring wellness and well-being. And this is just one, you know, one example of many. Next slide, please. And in actual fact, this is sort of a slide taken from one of our projects, which was called Adaptive Assistive Rehabilitative Technology Beyond the Clinic. And it was basically just trying to show how what we want to do is extract data from our from the end user, from the person who is requiring the care, whether it's obtrusive or unobtrusive, whether it's self-entered or whether it's obtained from the environment. And what we want to do is take that data, securely transmit it, process it, and we've come up with this term of individualized condition signature. So basically, it's a long-term tracking, if you like, of wellness. And this is almost independent of the data that is coming out of the individual. And so what I'm trying to advocate here is the fact that we can use, there's a lot of tools in our armory that we can use to judge and assess wellness. And so in this sort of low resource setting, we can be a bit inventive in the way we interpret information coming from people with different backgrounds, different settings, etc. Next slide, please. So finally, so in conclusion, what am I talking about? I think we're talking about a changed mindset of the end users, both the patients and the carers, and in brackets, the policymakers as well. So basically, this mindset there where I have to own my own health care, I have to own my own wellness management, and by my owning it and by my learning about how what I do affects my health, then I can affect change. Of course, this isn't new. They're not patients, but they're end users. And end users means that we should involve them in the communication side of things. We should try and be rewarding preemptive efforts to maintain wellness, for example. Recently in the news in the UK, there's been councils talking about, in a particular area in the UK, rewarding people for doing certain types of activities, combating obesity, for example. So, you know, a reward is not a bad thing. And also trying to integrate with everyday technology. So in other words, as I was trying to say earlier, there is technology out there that we can piggyback on top of, as well as, of course, bring in extra technology. And of course, I'm an advocate of this sort of data analysis side of things, where basically, if we can look at condition signatures or parameters that we can monitor, then we can do this longer term, where managing one's health isn't this episodic, I've taken my temperature, I've taken my blood pressure, you know, what's going on, but this longer term perspective of outcomes. And that's my last slide. So I can hand over to Isaac now. Thank you.
Amazing presentations, all of you. Thank you so much for such an important insight and different perspectives and complementing the information in a topic that is so important for the progress and the development of digital medicine at the global scale. We have visited from the situation in considerations in resource limited settings by Santosh, how do we standardize and considerations to standardize digital health technologies with Brené. Amy brought us to mind with the social determinants of health connected to digital medicine and the behavioral components and cultural and socioeconomical components connected to digital health. And Christopher really talked about how technology can impact digital health, digital medicine, and how technology can be utilized in multiple applications connected to health. Absolutely impressive. I would ask all of the participants online to please submit your questions using the chat box, the Q&A box. We welcome your participation, and this session is now open for questions from all of you to make this an interactive session. Delighted to be here with all of you. And while we look for those questions from the audience, let me just start by asking a few questions to all of you, my wonderful friends and panelists. And the first one will go for Santosh. Would you please tell me what can be some of the low-hanging fruits, talking in colloquial terms, if digital health entrepreneurs want to make a difference for healthcare in low-resource settings?
I think we discussed some of these, the easy actions, so-called low-resource settings, low-hanging fruits in low-resource settings. One of the favorite ones that I have, which Brinne and team is working on, is start from the design perspective, right? And think about which is the end user. Can we diversify the design? Can we diversify the usage from the design perspective? I think that can be a very good input, not only for low resource settings, and actually trying to merge this with one of the questions that has come up from Rachel. Is about why should some of these things be done by people who do not want to, say, for example, launch low resource settings, right? Can this have a broad implication? I feel that we have all seen this in our experience with the pandemic, right? The so-called normal or optimal resource settings can easily become low resource settings in a crisis, right? Is everything falls apart. We do not have the optimal resources. We don't have healthcare professionals standing around and helping us. And so in those cases, this resilience can come from understanding what can go wrong and how can low resource setting understanding can help us even in normal situations for a broader implication. So those two aspects is something that I would definitely think about, is think from the design perspective from the beginning, and don't think that you may not launch this or may not be used in low resource setting, but think also from a broader application perspective, resilience perspective, sustainability.
Great, thank you, Santosh. I will open the question for the panelists in case any of you would like to add to what Santosh mentioned.
Yeah, I could make a comment. And that is to think about all of the different ways that technology can actually be used to help people address their technology barriers. I feel like there's so much that isn't taken advantage of, such as being able to magnify font for people with visual difficulties, adding transcription for people with visual, with audio impairment, offering dictation for people with tactile difficulties. And when you think about different populations and the different kinds of barriers that they have to technology, you have seniors who might have these tactile and cognitive issues, but others with just generally low skills. But when you make changes for those populations, chances are it's going to benefit everybody. It's like in the US, when they put curb cuts in the sidewalk for people with wheelchairs, well, it turns out the people who benefited most from it were families with strollers. And so when you make these changes, you might see benefits that go much more broadly.
I couldn't agree more with you, Amy and Santosh. I would say, as a moderator, I'm adding my little two cents here. Multiple considerations really need to be taken into account when utilizing digital health technologies in resource limited settings and at the global scale. And you are pointing out that some of them, I couldn't agree more with those points that you made. It's important, in my opinion, also, I typically think with the final goal first, what do I want to accomplish? And then backtrack. How can I get to that final end? And understanding operational issues, feasibility issues, the situation, the country situation, or the setting situation, in terms of all the multiple aspects that you are discussing, I find that personally very, very fruitful in terms of implementing projects for connected to digital health. We're going in the direction of digitalization and global digitalization. So this is here to stay and to be amplified, and all of your experiences are rich and important. So I would remind the audience online to please submit questions online, and I will go next. Thank you again for your answers and your insight. And I will go next to my next question, and this I will start with Brinne. And then I will ask all of you to chime in as you find something to add to it. So Brinne, can you give me an example of how one might evaluate the usability of the digital medicine technology, and this considering the globality of the situation? and the resource limiting settings?
Yeah, absolutely. This is a great question, Isaac. So, you know, let's look at an example like something that's very common, sleep monitors, right? So examples of questions that you may want to evaluate during usability testing might include, can a full night of sleep be recorded, transmitted, and stored without data loss? And so if we think about considerations in low resource settings, this may include, you know, broadband internet access. It might be ensuring that data transfer will work on older devices or older software versions that are, you know, only available on some of these older devices. To ensure that we can deploy these sleep monitors in low resource settings. So in terms of a usability analysis, this is going to be more quantitative in nature, right? You can examine objective numbers measuring data loss in these different situations. But let's take a different question. So how about, can data visualization be interpreted by the users? So, you know, you have a sleep monitor and maybe you have an app that shows some kind of representation of your sleep over time. Can this visualization, can these numbers actually be interpreted and be useful to the users? And here is where you really want to be considering digital literacy and making sure your usability testing, you know, you're relying on looking at potential users with a broad range of digital literacy skills. And you really want to rely here on more qualitative approaches. So things like focus groups and surveys and interviews, and to really try to understand each person's perspective when evaluating your visualization for usefulness. So these are just a couple of examples of questions that you might ask when evaluating sleep monitors for usability in low resource settings, but very important questions, right? And things that need to be asked very early on in the process. And this comes to another one of Rachel's questions, which was, you know, I think she was saying, let me pull up the question here. She says, deploying digital health tools in low resource settings adds additional steps and difficulty in an already difficult field. Often the pushback on equity is akin to, we need to perfect our product and operations first before we worry about equity. But really you need to think about equity in the very beginning, right? Like in the initial design stages, when you're initially designing, developing your device, that is the time to think about equity. And we have an amazing opportunity within digital medicine to use these tools to promote equity. So we really, really need to be doing that from those initial stages.
Great, thank you, Brené. Yes, I was going to get into Rachel's questions, but we have been covering the operational and feasibility issues at the same time. So great, great insights. Any additional comments on this? And I want to make sure that I go to my next two panelists with additional questions. So if not.
One quick addition to Brené, and that is you need to think about the device quality and the person's access to it. So if a whole household is, say, sharing a smartphone, but it's something that the phone needs to be with the person all the time, that's, you know, person is not going to have equitable access. And similarly with data, at least in the US, poor urban populations do not have access to affordable high-speed broadband, and they might not have data plans on their cell phones. And so, you know, if something uses a lot of data or has to be constantly connecting, that's really going to be a barrier for someone with low income or living in an area that's been digitally redlined.
Great.
Yeah, just
thank
want
you.
To add one more point here, and again, answering one of the points that Brené already talked about for Rachel's question, is we do not need to think about all of these low resource settings together, right? We can take them one by one. And so, for example, you know, unavailability of broadband, can we have users still use and, you know, the data gets stored locally? And then they can have this, you know, intermittent step where they can then hopefully whenever they get access to a broadband, they're able to upload. And these require very small adjustments to the way you're storing the data, you're analyzing the data, and helping, you know, some of these peripheral use cases to begin with, and then start going into the core issue and try to think about product design from that perspective. So it's not that you don't need to get, you know, overwhelmed with all of these points altogether.
Thank you, Santosh. Let me go to Christopher for one moment. I would like to get insight from him in regards to, can the use of consumer electronics and technology be part of the solution towards equity in healthcare tech?
Yeah, I think as I said earlier, that I think there's a lot of different ways in which information can be extracted from people with in different settings. Of course, if you don't have a broadband connection, having regularly uploading and downloading data is not really doable. However, for example, if you have an electricity supply, data information is available from there. And I believe increasingly around the world, meters are being read wirelessly, for example, where the information is transmitted wirelessly through the power grid. So what I'm trying to get at is that there are means and ways of getting information in and out. And here's a novel idea. Why, you know, I own my data. Why don't I sell my data? Why don't I get my the power company to give me money off my power bill by allowing them to access anonymized data around my behavior, for example? You know, I'm making this up as I go along, but it, basically it's information that is required. It's information that as providers, whether it's healthcare providers or technology providers, it's invaluable data. It's a commodity. So why can't that be included in the use of these types of devices? So I think there's a lot to be explored in the use of sort of off-the-shelf commercial devices and being clever in the way we extract information. So there's a lot to be had, I think, there.
Excellent. Thank you so much. And so there is one quick question from the audience, and that is in regards to, I think, deploying digital health tools in low resource settings adds additional steps in and difficulty. I think Renee was talking about the same question. And so here is in regards to what is the team's response or the panelists' response to the kind of pushback in terms of the technology versus having the operations figure it out and at the beginning. We have only 1 minute. So if you want to add something else to that question, please do so.
Yeah, from my perspective, I think it's this getting you to think outside the box sometimes will get you to a solution that you wouldn't have otherwise achieved. So if we started with the objective of being able to, how can we routinely get information from someone who doesn't have broadband, for example? And if you start with that premise, you can probably arrive at some really interesting solutions that you wouldn't even have arrived at if you took the assumption we're only going to apply our technology to people who have, you know, regular data transmission.
Excellent. Thank you, Christopher. And I would like to thank all of you panelists for this wonderful session and information. If you have one word to say, that will be, I could say on behalf of all of you, there are multiple factors to consider to taking care of digital medicine in low resource settings. And we have discussed them here today. Multiple considerations for the health technology developers. I thank you all, panelists, and I thank you all attendees online. And we will be seeing you in the next time webinar that is set up for January. Back to you, Patel.
Thank you, Isaac. A really good conversation. I'll make sure I keep it quick in 30 seconds so everyone can go back to their next meeting in the top of the hour, but really, really great conversations discussing some action-oriented suggestions, resources, what could we think about? So really appreciate your leadership in driving this research and being a part of today. For everyone on the call today who are interested, our next virtual journal club is happening next week, December 14th, 11 a.m. same time, where Dr. Vihar would be talking about digital medicine and the curse of dimensionality in terms of when we are building these AI models, what are the things that we should be considering, how we can make sure that those are built without bias. So please tune in, and we look forward to having you next week. Have a wonderful rest of the day. And again, thank you to everyone who tuned in today and all our amazing speakers for sharing your incredible thoughts, insights, and suggestions. Have a wonderful day, everyone. Bye-bye.
Thanks. Goodbye.